Good day, everybody. Welcome to the podcast. I'm Data with Nathaniel Evans. Today, my show is Mindful Money Mastery, Empowering Financial Freedom and Entrepreneurism. So today, we're looking at how to basically focus on new change and real change in our lives. I have my guest, Joe Robinson, and he was already scheduled, but he didn't show up at this point. But the show has to go on. We can still have this discussion. And, you know, I was really looking forward to this discussion as well, because this individual focused on leadership of helping individuals that are coming out of prison. And I see I'm helping them find a new niche in life. You know, when you come out of prison, there's host of obstacles that you must face in order to get your life back on track. And it's not just all financial, but it's also, you know, rebuilding family values, social values, you know, really starting to believe in yourself once again as an individual and knowing that you have what it takes to make a difference in the world, you know, within yourself as well as with others. And I believe this conversation is very essential for us at this particular time. You know, not just because we're going through economical upheavals and things of that nature, but because finances, in a way, is how people get to identify themselves. You know, it's a, in a sense, it's a value system that people uses to basically determine what success looks like and what failure looks like. And within this value system, there are many aspects to point out, you know. Is it essential to have wealth in this time? Is it important to build new family values and new family structures? We are looking at a time where it's important to know I think my guest is trying to come in. Let me see if he got here. It's important to know what is essential for our lives and why do we define finances as something that's being essential? Is it to build families? Is it to build communities? Is it to build legacies, foundations, things of that nature? And I'm sorry, guys, but he's saying that he's here, but I don't see him. And I'm trying to get him on the show. So that it was some type of misunderstanding, I don't know why, but he should be here in a minute. So I'm getting back to this point here. What is the point of having finances in this particular time, right? It can be to rebuild family values, social values, to create legacies, to use it as a component of self-identification. Like, why do we actually want to be financially secure and established in the world? Is it to bring forth good or is it to bring forth harm? When we're looking at empowering financial freedom and entrepreneurism, there's a whole host of events that we have to go through. We have to basically retrain ourselves to walk in a certain way. We have to become more structured. We have to have find value in things in order for us to actually increase so we can come into a new space of awareness. And as I look at it, it's basically not an overnight success, right? It's basically, you know, locking your feet in, you know, digging your feet into the dirt and basically building, you know, step by step, you know, slowly but surely. And actually having principles of thought that will actually allow you to actually, you know, break through certain normalcies. You know, we might have been, you know, lackadaisical, or we might not have had certain principles when we came out of prison. You know, how do you actually have a financial mindset when you're in prison you're making like, what, 10 cents an hour and things of that nature, 16 cents an hour. So how, when you come out of prison, do you actually establish this concept that, you know, I'm going to create wealth? And wealth is a space where you have to invest in it in order for it to increase you. And then once you obtain wealth, you have to have the knowledge to actually keep it. Because many people will obtain wealth, but then they will lose that wealth by, you know, indulging in different activities, getting into different type of investments, and not really learning or keeping the principles that they actually use to get there in the first place. So I'm learning, even by interacting with individuals like Joe Robinson, I hope we'll be on in a few minutes, that there are certain strategies and certain procedures that we can use to ensure that we reach new plateaus of economical success. And as we reach into those new spaces, you know, what would the world look like for us? Would it become more enlightening? You know, would it be a principal thing now? Would it be more valuable because we have, you know, we have life, you know, we have this money? And so, you know, it's just a thought process of learning, why do we want this thing in our lives so bad? And once we get it, like, what is it that we're going to do with it? You know, how are we going to be able to make a true difference and do something on a higher level? And there's been some type of misunderstanding because he still hasn't come into the show. And he's saying he can see me, but I don't see him. And I'm going to do it again for some reason. I got to keep following this link. You know. I got to keep following this link for some reason. Everybody's not savvy, I guess, when it comes to these podcasts and getting on these podcasts. You know, maybe he sees me online, but he has to be on the show so I can interact with him. And it just shows, like, principles, you know, learning the new aspects of life, the new technologies, the new spaces of awareness that we have to learn. Because sometimes we get used to old processes and dealing with the same concept. Even when we make money, we may get to a point where it's like, this is who I am, this is what I'm about. I'm not going to change certain tactics or concepts or principles. I'm going to keep myself locked into this certain space. I'm going to remain this person like always because this is how I made my money. And when you come out of prison and any places where you have to start over, you know, as far as me, like house fires, I've been in house fires, things of that nature. You have to start over. You know, you have to understand that you have to be in a space where you can pivot. You have to be in a space where you can, you know, see the enlightenment of your life, see that your life has value and your life is a principle for you in order to learn new strategies and new tactics in order to be, you know, that essence of the life that you wanted to be. You know, and overnight success is something that I hear about all the time, especially that I'll be on social media platforms, I'll be talking to some people. You know, they got these concepts where, you know, let's make money fast. You can do this real quick. You can do this real quick. And then it's like when you get into business with people, it's like there's a process. You know, you gotta train for a year, right? You gotta do this for this amount of time, right? And it just shows that there's no overnight success. It just shows that you have to really lock yourself in and you have to be able to get through all the upheavals that you're going to experience. You got to climb these different hills. You got to climb down these hills, you know, and you got to learn how to play on different playing fields. You know, creating a podcast is a space where you wanted to grow, you know, you want to be monetized, you want to have sponsorships, but everybody looks for you to be actually successful before they really start working with you in these different spaces. You know, they want you to learn, you know, how they want to learn that you know what you're doing, and nobody want to basically take risks off a new product or a new service without them seeing that it actually works. But you know, as we journey through life, we see that everything that is huge now started small. And you have people that was invested in these different things that ensure that they learn, you know, what is really going on. And I don't know what's happening with Joe Robinson. He still hasn't followed the link. I asked him to follow the link. I sent the link like 3 times. He's telling me he's on, he sees me, but this is supposed to be like an interview discussion and not just him watching me on the platform. And I'm learning that, you know, we really have to take value in connecting with one another and really like building principles with one another so we can increase ourselves. You know, learning, you know, having achieved success in this society, you know, sometimes, you know, it's like, what is the value systems that's pertaining to success? You know, what are the value systems that's pertaining to, you know, I did this, I did that, you know, I locked myself in, you know, I know how to build this system, I know how to build that system. But when we're dealing with finances, that's about any type of business structure, is learning the principle of how to build one another and how to increase one another. I think that's something that is really, you know, lacking in the spaces of dealing with value systems around money. Right? What is that? How is that value system going to make us into different people? And how is it going to make us into better people? Today is the day I've really been thinking about some things, you know, and I really feel as if, you know, money is essential. I believe that it has its principal values, but I believe like money is like a seed, right? It has to be planted in order for it to be cultivated. And you don't want to plant a seed in one place. You plant a seed in multiple places so it can grow, you know, simultaneously. So if one tree was basically rot out, or one tree was basically being blown down by a storm or something like that, the other seeds, you know, that form trees will actually be there for you to cultivate from those things and to keep your value system going in life. And the seed of money is a value system that we really need, you know, to ensure that our neighbors live good lives, we live good lives, that when we walk through our community, you know, basically correlates with that level of success, right? What does our communities look like? What do our parks and schools look like? You know, is it just me that's successful on the block, or is it multiple people that's successful in my community? You know, do I share who I really, really is? And do I really care about economical wealth in the way that I actually speak about it? And learning how to increase each other and using the things that we have to improve one another is that value system, right? And this is what I want to actually talk about today with Joe is, you know, mindful money mastery. Why is it important to master money? You know, why is it important to be mindful about money? And how does that really make you into a new individual, into the world? Or how does it allow you to shred off the old clothing and put on new clothing? And why is it really, really, really important to you to be able to do that? And today, you know, I usually go an hour when I have a guest, but my guest didn't show up. So I'm just going to go for half an hour and have this conversation, right? And empowering financial freedom. Let's think about that. How do you empower financial freedom in a world where finances is actually being lopsided? There's an imbalance in the world when it comes to finances, right? And money flows, you know, like the river. It comes and it goes, you know, and it's always seeking to spread itself out and to connect itself into new spaces, into a new world. The more money we get, you know, the more our lives increase. You know, we may go to better schools, we change our places of worship, you know, we change the style of our clothing, you know, we upgrade new cars and things of that nature. But without money, right, what is empowering about you? If you don't have money, what is the freedom of your life? And if you have financial freedom, will you still have financial freedom in a sense without the money? Or is that an oxymoron? To have financial freedom without money, how do you have financial freedom without money? Or do you need money in order to have financial freedom in this world? The blessings of life is actually you in real time and you learning about who you are, whether you have money or not. Right, we're talking about entrepreneurism, and this has been a concept that has been actually taking over the world. Right, it has been moving through the land. You know, there's a lot of people that reach out to me every day on LinkedIn, you know, Instagram, things of that nature, and it speaks about, you know, entrepreneurism. It speaks about their life coach, that they can build my podcast, that they can build my social media platforms, and when you talk to them, 90% of the time when I talk to these different individuals, they say me, and then when I connect to them, they have a team. So I've been looking at that, you know, is financial freedom a individual thing, or is it a collective stronghold? Because most of the marketers or the advertisers that I talk to, they already have a team in place. They're already part of a team. It's not you or one-on-one basis where they're just working with you and they're the only individual that's on the team or part of the process that's going to help you individually to build your business up. They have networks of teams that they're actually working with in order to ensure that they stay in the space of financial freedom. Because, like I said, you plant different seeds in different spaces. So if you have a team, those are different seeds that's planted in different spaces. So even when you fall short, not able to get, you know, the contracts that you need within that month period, other people on the team can actually fill that void, and then you still could turn around and do the work that you specialize in with inside that team. So every time that you reach out to individuals, you may not be able to solidify the relationship, but there are other people that's in the team that's going to be able to solidify that relationship. And I just want you to see what I'm trying to say here. Financial freedom is associated to team etiquettes and team development. You can work for a job for the next 20 years and never receive financial freedom. You would never even know what financial freedom looked like, and you've been working for a job for 20 years, and you may be making $100,000 a year, $150,000 a year, right? $50,000 a year, $6,000 a year. But financial freedom is a space where you really don't got to work for the money. The money actually just comes to you, right? How many of us have that space where money just flows to us constantly without us actually have to get up, you know, and start working on our computer or get on a form or go into, you know, meetings with people and things of that nature to convince them to do business with us, or just to be in a space where people want to be able to do business with you? Is that financial freedom? Financial freedom is actually being have control of your time, you know, control of your development as an individual, and learning that the steps that you make in this life are essential to your growth and development, and also in opposition can be detrimental to your growth and development as well. The people that you connect with or choose not to connect with are essential aspects of what that financial freedom looks like. And I've been on many different conferences and panels and things of that nature, and I've learned in certain spaces that collectivity is the beginning of our financial freedom in the world. How do we build teams amongst ourselves, especially with people that come out of prison? How many of us in this mindset that we're going to actually sit down and we're going to talk and build with 20 different men and women to actually build an infrastructure that we can stand on, right? And individuals that are financial free, right? When does your financial freedom run out? When is it you come to a point where, you know what, I don't want to be the only one that's financially free. I want to financially free other people as well. You know, I'm going to be a philanthropist. I'm going to be a donator. You know, I'm going to, you know, support certain causes that will bring forth life. And now, and I was just about to, but my guest showed up because I was just about
to. It took me a half hour. Yeah, I apologize. I've been trying since 2 o'clock. I don't use StreamYard for some reason. I don't know.
It's just you guys got to follow the link.
I tried to. I think I started. I apologize again for you and everybody because I'm big on time, but I was determined. I was like, man, and I'm telling you, I've been here since 2 o'clock trying to figure this out.
Oh, that's you should have reached out to me. I'd have definitely had to help you walk through it.
Yeah,
you know, we could always get a Zoom beforehand, you know.
Yeah, that's my bad. I thought it was going to be 1, 2, 3. I was like, okay, it's no big deal. And then, I went to 2 different joints. I don't know.
Preparation. You know, you got mindful money mastery, right? So it's like, you know, you know about preparation, and you know also you know about different obstacles that we face.
When we're
coming to new spaces.
Yes,
right. But people was looking. They was looking for you. You know, I was definitely looking for you, and happy to have you here, brother.
Yeah.
How your day been going so far? Besides, you know,
it's going well. Normally, you know, Sunday's a laid back day, but I had a Zoom call earlier at noon. So then a little break in between. And then, again, I apologize. Usually I'm like punctual on time. So I get, and 2 o'clock, like I said, it was frustrating. But now I know I had the wrong link. I went into the 2 other ones. What you sent me something else, and I went into that, and I saw I'm not even making sense, but I went to 2 other things that you sent me, and then I said, let me try it like this. So it worked. So again, I apologize.
Awesome, yes.
I'm at my house now, in my bedroom.
yeah, that's cool, man. So once again, guys, this is IAMTHEDATA. You know, and today we're talking about mindful money mastery with Joseph Robinson. And he's asked, you know, he has a book that came out, and I've seen that book a couple of times. What's the name of that book? It was
Think Outside the Cell. Yep.
Think Outside the Cell. Yeah. I heard about that book a couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
And you wrote that book. Well, I'm not sure you wrote that book while you was incarcerated.
While I was incarcerated, it's now revised. I wrote it in 2007. I was I'm in New York State, so I wrote it in one of the prisons while I was upstate.
So I don't really do questions, but I guess, you know, because of the platform and the stuff that you're dealing with, I think questions will be appropriate. While you was incarcerated, what was it that you saw that this concept of dealing with finances outside the cell was so important while you was actually inside the cell?
For me, it was easy. I went in many years ago, 3 decades ago. I was in my early 20s, facing a lot of time, and, you know, literally and figuratively, meaning literally facing time, but also having a lot of time to think, to really think. And do some serious introspection. And so I always say I consider myself fortunate that the light bulb, so to speak, went off early. I was like, man, I don't like living like this, right? So that means I got to think differently. I have to move differently. My behavior has to change. And so I started, like I said, reflecting, doing a lot of introspection. And what I came up with was that a lot of times when I got in trouble when I was younger, it was motivated by money and material things, right? It was just really that simple. The lack of money lack of money and also misdirected ways of thinking about money. Because, you know, just because you lack money doesn't mean you're going to commit crimes, right? But I did. Growing up in the crack era in the mid-80s in New York City, it was crazy. And so I got caught up in that. And so when I was early on in my prison stint, I realized that the main thing that kept getting me in trouble was money, right? So I started going to, so I said, if I don't want to go back to prison, then I need to understand how money works, right? From a practical standpoint, but also from an emotional, a psychological standpoint. Because for most of us, money, we have emotional and psychological attachments to money, right? It's not just a job. We have certain feelings about it, certain fears and anxiety, a whole bunch of things. Money brings up all sorts of things for different people. And for many of us, several things in the same person. And so when I realized that I needed to, what I realized is I needed to like tackle it, like to really confront it head on. Right. So instead of just saying, oh, it's money, I just go home. You know, when I go home, I'll just get a job. I wanted more than just a job. I really wanted to understand this and to be able to help other people. Now, I didn't get that deep in it early on. I was only like 23, 24 years old back then. But the wheels started to turn. Like there was something bigger for me in life than being in, in a prison cell. Right. Reading books and everything else. And so in 1995, so from 93 to 95, I was like reading up about personal finance, entrepreneurship, and I took to it readily. Like it was real easy for me. I wasn't intimidated. I was just like a sponge, basically. And so in 1995 is when I taught my first class on personal finance. Again, I was incarcerated. And most of the men, well, all of them, man, were all older than me. So I was like 25, but some of them 35, 40, 45, you know. And I saw that they really was paying attention. Some of them had money saved up. They was thinking about investing in mutual funds and stocks and stuff. And I had some answers. So I was able to provide that. And then from there, it was no turning back from there. I just kept teaching. Word got around in the prison that I was like, oh, he knows stuff when it comes to that. So and then many years later, got married in 2005, met my wife in 2003, again, while I was incarcerated. We then... because she's retired now, but she was a journalist at the New York Times. She was a senior editor, so a very good writer and editor. And I said, people kept coming to me. By then, I had been teaching a lot of classes in the prison. They allowed me to teach classes. I got other facilitators to also co-facilitate. And people began to ask me outside of class in the workout yard, in the gym, all over the place, asking me questions about personal finance, asking me questions about entrepreneurship. And I, would say, if I didn't know something, I would say, listen, I don't know this much. I can tell you this, but, here's where you can find more information. And so the light bulb went off, the entrepreneur in me, the hustler, in me said, you need to write a book. Because you're answering all these questions to individuals, you need to put it, package it in a book so that you can reach more people, right? And so that's what I did in 2007. So I started working on it in 2006, and then we self-published in 2007, and then went on to do a whole bunch of other things. And now I have the revised edition. So the one that you have, it looks a little different. This is a new cover now. So and this is fresh. This is like, came out this month, like 2 weeks ago.
So that is that the one I seen on Amazon for like $99 or something like that? Is that the price for it?
The first one, yeah. I got in touch with Amazon about because the other copy, they still have it on there. We don't sell the old copy anymore.
Okay.
We don't sell that. I'm sure that probably I'm working on getting that taken down. But
yeah, because I said a $99, I was like, well, it got to be a phenomenal read. Like,
it is a phenomenal read.
I'm just saying, after the first two pages, I'm ready to go. Like, I'm about to get rich.
right, exactly. No, it's actually $16.99 though.
And then they probably made a misprint, And I look at that, I don't really say like it's a scavenge for me. If I wanted to buy it, I could buy it. It's just like, if you people that's coming out of prison, and it's like your population, and they first come out of prison and it's like $99. And like, wow, I just came out of prison with $40 or $60 or $100. Like, I can't even really afford this concept. you know, that helped me really change my life. You know, maybe even if I don't apply it the way that the book tells me to apply it, it will, in a sense, change my frame of thinking. And even like for people that's come out of prison, do you think that, or you ever use the approach for like sponsors buying the books for people that come out of prison to ensure that they will have the ability to actually get access to the book?
Yeah, no, that is something that I've considered. And one of the things like this, not this week, the 29th of this month, I think that's next Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, I'm going to give a talk at an organization in Brooklyn, New York, the Osborne Association. And so I will, you know, I have connections at a lot of these different reentry organizations. It did time with a lot of them.
Brooklyn, so that's Ransom Street, right?
That's their main office, but they have a you're absolutely right. That's 175 Remsen Street.
Yeah,
what I'm going to is the one in Brownsville section, and that is their supportive housing unit. So I'm going to speak to the men directly there, and then so I'm going to talk about sponsorship. So to your point earlier, no, I wouldn't not say ever, but I wouldn't come out the gate and expect people who just came home to spend $99 on a book. So I'm definitely trying to get that free now on Amazon. I'm like, yo, take that. That's not, we never charge that. I think that's a, what you call it? Like a secondary market or whatever. I don't know how that works, but, and that was under a different, we had a Resilience Multimedia was our publishing company. So we no longer have that. It's defunct. Right. Mm-hmm. So, but apparently there's some aftermarket on Amazon. So I'm trying to get that straightened out.
So you have Karen Ford. She popped in. She said, what was the name of the book?
Think Outside the Cell, An Entrepreneur's Guide for the Incarcerated and Formerly Incarcerated. And now it's, like I said, it's revived now.
And I've seen
I ain't trying to discourage no one.
I did see it, and I think that's something that's important for people when they're coming out of prison to be able to have access to these different tools and resources. And you know, especially like if you come home and you've been home for like a year and 2 years, and things are working for you, right? It's like everything is easy now because everything is working for you. But when you first came home, it was a very difficult process of establishing yourself and really getting yourself, get your footing when you're coming home. And I think sometimes we forget that, especially when we come home, we become successful, or we start breaking through the monotony, that other individuals are going to come behind us, and they might not have a good transition. Right, they might not have a support system. You say you had a great support system. Your wife used to work for the New York Times.
Yeah,
right. You was fortunate, so it was certain things that you didn't really have to think about. You know, when you first came out, you know, as far as like, you know, shelter, you know, pocket money, you know, a good establishment to grow in, and then like if you got stuck in your writing, you were like, yo. What can I put right here, right? You know what I'm saying? So that was a great support system that you have. And, you know, all of us look for those different support systems. And, you know, majority of people that come out, especially like 80% of them, don't have that type of structure.
Right.
It's not, you know, that's like a fantasy, you know what I mean? It's not really a truth. And even when I came home in 2007, I came home, you know, they give you $40 from the prison, and I had a couple of dollars, but you know, you save money in the prison system, they take away the $40. They don't give you the $40 on top of the money you save. So they basically like omit the whole $40. And it's like, wow, like
that's crazy.
Like I can't add the $40 to my income. Like
it's exactly.
Yeah. So it's really mind boggling when you transition out of systems like this and then you're seeking to get your footing. And you run into these financial obstacles, you run into these financial walls, you know, and you really want to make a difference in your life.
Yeah.
Right. So I was looking for it on Amazon. You said, I think I saw the sale. I was trying to find a new one.
I'll have to send another link. I have the link to it. I have to send a link to the the appropriate price, right?
You can send a link on here if you got it, so I can put it on the platform because I wasn't able to find it.
Okay,
let's on see. Amazon for some reason. I found the old one, but you said you have a new one.
Yeah, I don't understand.
I found the old one, but that's the one I put on your on the cover when I did the ad.
But
the new one, if you got it, just put here, and I'll put it up there so Karen and other people that want to look into it can use it. I think it will be a great supporting guide.
Yeah,
for organizations like the Osborne Association, Fortune Society,
exactly,
Exodus, you know, these organizations that have been around, that have been pillars for the space of reentry. And if they start using tactics such as this, financial freedom,
right,
then you can see that it will be a change in the reentry circle. Because
that's the goal.
You know, that's the goal, because when you come out of prison, if you go get a job, you know, you might get a job at Fortune Society, Osborne, things of that nature. That's not financial freedom.
Right.
Yeah, that's not financial freedom. Financial freedom is basically, you know, you sleep until like 1 o'clock in the morning and your money is ding, ding, ding. Right? It's not you getting up every day, you know, running to the job because you have to work these amount of hours.
Right.
That's not financial freedom, because now if you stop working at the job don't pay you, you know, for the next 5 years as a courtesy to ensure that you don't, you know, you don't fall through the cracks, right? Once you start working the job ends. So I think that this is important when you especially doing a speech at Osborne Association, to basically drill in the fact that, you know, they're not just entities that's there to, you know, give people opportunities for a job and stuff like that, but they are entities to ensure that we break the disparities that's actually associated to incarceration. And as you said, you was incarcerated many times over, and your incarceration was associated primarily to finances. You know, I got to get money. You know, I'm not trying to be like a poor person. You know, I want to get that new Lexus that came out. I want to get this. You know, I want to be able to take my wife or my girlfriend to nice spaces. I want to buy my children nice clothes. So these things are all essential, especially when you come out of prison. You feel like I got to catch up, right? Like I'm lost. I'm lost in the spaces. So there's something I have to do to catch up to everybody else in the world.
Right.
And this is where that danger actually takes place.
But let me say a couple of things, Nathan. One for me, because you raised a couple of good points. I just want to make sure I don't lose my thinking.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's right.
So one is, like you said, while on a material level, when it came to like finance, stuff like that, and even in terms of like housing, because I came home to a wife, that, like I said, I'm very humbled and grateful, you know, for her and for that. I work full time, have my business and go to school. So I'm juggling, like a lot of people, several hats. And so I work at a nonprofit law firm in Lower Manhattan, right, in the financial district. And prior to that, I had this is my second job since I've been home. I've been home 7 years. The first one was a job that was designed to help people, formerly incarcerated people, get jobs. But I say that to say that, so one of the things I realized even recently is that even though I've always, or well, for many years, had the entrepreneurial spirit and drive, is that, and even though I didn't struggle coming home, like materially, but this for all of us, men and women, right, who spend whether 6 months in jail or prison or whatever case might be, or many years, I think there's a internal reentry process as well. So that's where, you know, I would trip up, so to speak, right? Be called a PTSD, whatever you want to call it, right? Because there is, you know, some form of that we experience, right? Post-traumatic stress disorder. And so even though on the outside I was fine, it's like, okay, yeah, Joe, you know, he landed nicely. Yeah, some people say, right? He came home. It's, there a lot of, you know, people I did time with, they know my wife, she knows them, and from the visits over the years. And yet, still we struggled, to be honest, like in our relationship, you know, in terms of relearning each other, right? It's different, you know. I had the conjugal visits, the whole thing, but we never lived together. I met her while I was inside. So that was a process, right? And yeah, I appreciate it. So that was the process. And so, you know, but we got through it. You know, we went to therapy, the whole thing, the whole thing. We're both communicators, you know, the written word and verbally. And so that made a big difference as well. So I just wanted to point that out. As far as the different reentry organizations, I'm in talks with Exodus to do some talks with them. I'm going to do 3 talks this coming month in December. I don't know if you or your listeners are familiar. For those who are in New York City, there's an organization called Parole Preparation Project. And there's another one called RAP, Releasing Aging People in Prison. So I'm going to give
about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm going to give a talk on December 2nd, December 9th. And December 30th. So I have 3 of them lined up, you know, like 1.5-hour talks on different topics, right? So one is what I call, and this goes to the point that you was just alluding to, Nathaniel, is, you know, one of the things that really stands out for me and I'm like really passionate about, right? I went in my 20s, came out in my 40s, right? So I did a significant amount of time. Other times I got in trouble, I was 16, 17, 18, you know, in my teens, I didn't do state time, never did state time. So I kept, you know, Rikers Island, you know, Brooklyn House, you know, local jails and stuff like that. But then when I was 21, going on 22, as we used to say, I got the bonus, right? So mm-hmm. all in one fell swoop, so to speak, end up, you know, getting in trouble with the law and doing a significant amount of time. I say that to say that one of the things I realized when I talk to, you know, some of my friends who are, let's say, I'm in my early 50s, I'm 53, who are like 10 years older than me, for example, they're at the stage in their life when they're thinking about retirement, but they can't retire because they just did 20, 30 years. That really moves me, right? Really, really motivates me to really think about how we, you know, who those of us who do significant, you know, amounts of time in prison, how we can, I don't want to say play catch up, but how we could be smarter about our finances so that we are not 70, 75 having to still work or to just rely on Social Security because it's not, you know, because you miss so many years of work, right? On the outside, there's not going to be, you're going to get a small check. It's just that simple. That's the way the system mm-hmm. is set up. So I've come up with something called the new SSI method, right? And that's going to be one of my next books, right? That really lays out how to, you know, that something that speaks to us, to those of us that's done 15, 20 years and don't have a cushion or what do they call it? Not the, I can't think of the term, but basically in terms of your retirement, your nest egg, that was the one I was looking for. Where's the nest egg for people who did 25 years in prison? There's none. There's none. So we have to be the ones to map that out, to, you know, to figure out how to do it, you know, in a way that's smart and strategic and you know, calculating our risk. I mean, I'm not talking about jumping to Bitcoin and all this other stuff. No, that fast, you know, trying to get fast money got us, many of us, in prison.
Yeah.
So we ain't trying to repeat that. I just wanted to say that.
Yeah, that's true, because right now, even with looking at Mayor mm-hmm. Adams' campaign, mm-hmm. and his regime, for the last couple of years he's been in office, he has cut phenomenally the funds of nonprofit organizations. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. Osborne, Fourth Society, these different organizations on those lists of cuts. And when you cut money out of the organization, you're also cutting out incomes. You're also mm-hmm. cutting out stability of life, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And many of those individuals that actually fall under that chopping block, you know, how do they be able to bounce back from that cut? Because, you know, the reentry space is a small space. Mm-hmm. It may seem like it's big, but it's not, it's very small. So mm-hmm. if you lose a job in one reentry organization, you know, how prevalent is that you're going to actually be able to go right into another nonprofit and get a job when everybody is actually competing for those same opportunities,
yes.
especially when they come out of prison? Because these are like the only spaces that's actually been like a financial springboard mm-hmm. for individuals that want to work in a space of reentry, not just to work, but actually to come home and to make a difference, to change right. the mindset, the heart, and the spirit of people within mm-hmm. itself mm-hmm. and change the identity that incarceration has placed upon us.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Mm-hmm. because incarceration is a snare in the lives of people that actually been associated to it. And even amongst ourselves, we judge each other within that space.
Yeah.
And opportunities, like there's only one CEO of a company. It's not 1,000 CEOs, it's only one CEO, right? Mm-hmm. And then you might only have organization might only have 20 slots for case managers. So you know, you have to find a way how you're gonna get in there. And it's only one director per program. And so how do you get into these different spaces to ensure that your life has a foundation to it? And that just goes into another question I wanted to ask you real quick was, I see you going into the nonprofit sectors and stuff, and you're talking about the book and financial freedom. How have you been able to go back into the prison systems to actually teach this concept as well?
I have not yet. I have gone into prisons to visit friends, actually, who I left behind. But as far as to teach, I have not. That's something in 2024 that I intend to do across the country, throughout the state, New York State. You know, and I'm saying this with all humility. Like I said, the book first came out in 2007. It's so it's been around, right? It's been around for years. Many people know about it. A lot of people have told me, you know, that it's changed their lives, and I see the evidence of it for some people, right? They got businesses, they got nonprofits, you know, and they were really inspired. So, like I said, I'm humbled when I say that. My next step is to go inside the prisons, because similar to the book, I can reach more people that way, as opposed to one-on-one with someone. I can, you know, have some of these, like the organizations, the on the inside, have them put together their meetings and stuff like that, or events, and do it that way. So I look forward to doing that. You know, in the coming year, this is going to be a big year. I got a lot of, and I'm gonna say, a lot of things lined up. I got a lot of things lined up for 2020.
I think it's going to turn out well for you as well. You know, because the Department of Correction also has registries that you can actually connect your book to, because this is how people go shopping now. You know, for food and clothing and stuff like that, it has to be one of the registered stores they have. So that's also another approach.
Another app, that you appreciate can take, that. Yeah.
You know, that you can use to actually increase, you know, your visibility of actually being this expert and knowing that. Because I was at a conference, I was at a rally a couple of weeks ago, and there's a guy that came home after 16 years, and he asked this man that been in a nonprofit for a while, you know, how can you help me? You know, I just came up to 16 years. I only been home for like a couple of weeks. And how can you help me? And the man told him to have patience. Right. And, you know, this, you know, these men that got prominent positions in a nonprofit, they've been around for a while. They have been able to establish their families. They have been able to create certain legacies around who they are within particular communities and things of that nature. And the man told the man to have patience. So, you know, we look into a world where, you know, where eventually some of us are going to get out, right? We may go to prison for 10 years, you know, 15 years, 20 years, but we're going to come out. And when we come out, the word patience is a phenomenal word when you're in a space, when you're in a space of humility, when you're in a space of purpose, when you're in a space of your path. But when you're fresh off the chopping block,
and you
ain't got nothing to wear, you know,
you don't know
how you're gonna feed yourself.
Like you
sitting in one of those detrimental shelters that's more volatile than the prison system within itself. The concept of having patience doesn't even exist.
It doesn't even exist. That's the wrong. I mean, I'll say this in my work. You know, sometimes talks about helping clients manage expectations, not lower them, but manage them.
Tell
someone be patient, and they just coming out. You first of all, like you said, many of these organizations are run by formerly incarcerated men and women. So you've been in their shoes in some way or another. Like, you know, the person who's the director of the program was once a client, right? So you can't forget where you came from. I mean, that's my thing. I keep the humility.
It's about being realistic, man, because it's the prison world is a dangerous world, man. You know, I've been in there myself, and some of my friends did not make it out. You know, some of my friends that did make it out did not make it out as a whole person.
Right.
And some of us that did make it out, now we're faced with challenges as far as We don't have those support systems. My mother's not here no more. Our father's not here. Our grandmas and grandfathers that we depended on. Our brothers and sisters may not be here anymore. Mm-hmm. And now we're basically like starting a whole new life.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah.
And we look for these entities, like these organizations, mm-hmm. to help us become established in a world that's extraneous to us. Mm-hmm. You know, you did 10 years, you came home, you seen cell phones, mm-hmm. you seen metro cards before you had peepers and you had mm-hmm. tokens.
Right.
So now it's like, wow, you know, like this is what is
it's a new world.
You
know? Exactly. That's how I came on.
That's how it's a new world. So, you know, I definitely commend you on this path, you know. Mm-hmm. And I hope we can actually connect again and do a whole other interview.
Yeah, we could do it. And now I know how to get it, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
Figure it out. Let me say this too, Nathan. So I read a book. I'm an avid reader. I read this book called The Millionaire Fast Lane. Really good book, right?
Okay.
What is his name? I forgot his first name. His last name is DeMarco. MJ DeMarco. That's his name. MJ DeMarco. It's excellent, excellent, excellent. Right? The Millionaire Fast Lane. And it's a metaphor. He talks about three different lanes, right? In life, when you talk about finances, the sidewalk, and the fast lane. The sidewalk is, you know, a person that's metaphorically speaking, who's not, or perhaps is not working, who is on, you know, like with some of us, like on the margins of society, right? Unemployed, maybe on public assistance, or whatever the case might be. So it's not, you know, that's their situation. The slow lane is what most of us are in, right? Which is the, you know, 9 to 5, you got a 401k if you're lucky, maybe you have an IRA as well. So you're investing over the long term, right? To have some type of cushion, some nest egg like we talked about earlier, right? There's nothing wrong with that. That's the slow lane, right? You'll get there, but it'll take you 30, 40 years. And this is what they teach us, right? Go to school, you get your degree. Let's say if you go straight from high school to college, 22, you got a BA or BS or whatever. If you want to go further, you know, post-secondary education, you could do that. And then you work the next 30, 40 years, and then you get the pot of gold at the end. That's basically what we've been taught, right? What he talks about and really emphasizes is the fast lane. The fast lane is what we're talking about here. Entrepreneurship. And other types of ownership, right? Because you can have intellectual property. That's one way. That's one way to get at it as well, by having, you know, whether it's licensing, trademarks, patents, copyrights, you know, those type of things. So you notice, like with let's say people who, you know, some of our peers who went into the rap game, for example, right? They made money from, you know, their music, but a lot of them made it from other things, right? They made it from the fashion. They made it from the alcohol or, you know, lifestyle type of things. That's the fast lane. All those things are part of the fast lane. Well, I'll just say this last thing. One of the things that he pointed out that really resonated with me is that, again, nothing against the slow lane, right? I'd rather people work than not have a job, right? I'd rather mm-hmm. people have invest in stocks and bonds. I promote that, and I actually do too, right? So it's something I am big on, because everyone is not going to be an entrepreneur. Let's just be realistic. Whether you're formerly incarcerated or not, you're not going to be. It's hard work. It's no joke, right? And so everybody's not up to it. You really have to be passionate about this. What keeps me going is that I love this and I love helping our people. That's what keeps me going. So even on the days when I'm like stressed, I'm like, God, man, I ain't, you know, 7 days went by, I ain't take a break yet. You know, don't get me wrong, I do take my breaks, I do get my vacations and stuff like that, but I push it, like how you said earlier, like, you know, 9 to 5 is 9 to 5, right? You're on somebody else's time. That's the bottom line, right? I make good salary right now on my job, but I'm still at somebody else's time. I can't stop, right? I don't have the luxury, right, to just stop right now. Now 2024 is going to be a different story. I'm gonna tell you that, right?
Yeah, creating a new lane.
A new lane. I'm going to the fast lane, right? I'm stepping into it like fully, like not partly in the, you know, the slow lane, partly in the fast lane. 2 feet planted firmly in the fast lane. That is my goal between now and this time next year. And we all, I ain't gonna say we all know, but a lot of us know, you know, we know how to hustle. I know how to make it happen. So it's not like it's just changing it up from the negativity to the positivity. So the main point I was trying to make is that the fast lane, it's not for everyone, but it's where it's at. If you're talking about building wealth, it is the fast lane. The slow lane is not going to get you to wealth, straight up. You might get comfortable. I'm comfortable now. I'm beyond, I'm comfortable now. I don't want to be comfortable, right? I want to go beyond comfortable, right? Because when we are comfortable, I believe in general, right, we can unconsciously settle for mediocrity. That's one, right? We settle for anything. We get in our little comfort zone, our little rut. We don't push ourselves. We don't live fully. And what I learned is that it's not about things and all that, but it's about having meaning in life and significance, right? Significance and making a difference in people's lives. And I'm not just saying that. It's not, I really do believe I've been since 1995, been, like I said, teaching entrepreneurship. I could keep it to myself, but it wouldn't be, I wouldn't get any satisfaction out of that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because where you're going to go in your own development of life if you keep it to yourself. Mm-hmm. We speak of a world and we talk about, because right now I'm doing my master in public administration.
Nice.
And I'm in economics, one of my economic classes. And, it's basically speaking about, like, one man has $1 billion and another man only has $10, right? Mm-hmm. And then the one that got $1 billion keeps talking about their money. But it's an imbalance when we look at the economics that's in the world. There's a major imbalance.
Yes,
Don't really have to do anything, and where other people have to do these things to buy into life. We are buying into life. We're working these jobs, and we have to buy into this life. And then when a lot of time when you go into these different spaces, the identity of who you are, a lot of time it shifts. Mm-hmm. You have become the identity of the places that you're working in, because you got to stand according to their morals, their values, mm-hmm. their mission statement. Mm-hmm. The vision statements, and then after a while, like you said, you get comfortable, and you start forgetting about your own dreams. Like you come home, you're tired, and it's like it's 8 o'clock. You're like, I want to go to bed, but you got to finish this book, or you got to finish writing this course, or you got to finish writing out this one page letter and things of that nature. And it's like you have all these different distractions that actually take place.
Exactly.
Because when you're coming home, you're moving in multiple directions at the same time. You're trying to get your healthcare up, you're trying to build your family, you're trying to get your finances up, you're trying to get a decent wardrobe, you're trying to get these things that seem to be simplistic, but they are essential to your overall growth and development.
Exactly. No, exactly.
And there is no quick fix. Yeah.
I know we coming up on time, and I'll be happy to do another one. Just let me know. We'll make sure 10 minutes before we set up and all that,
definitely.
But I just wanted to say that, like I said, you raised some good points because, like I said, I work. So when I come home, most days I am tired, and my wife's, she's sitting in. So even, I look at the business side is the business side, right? Meaning what I'm getting at is that business is time consuming, right? So my wife understands that. I understand that. But when you have business, work, school, it squeezes out the marriage, and that's not good. Like we good, because my wife, luckily, and I'm not saying this like I'm gonna, continue to, along this path, but she's, she's more late, meaning she's more
understanding.
Understanding, and she's like I wouldn't say a loner, but I'm more the sociable type, put it that way. So she got her news going on, and she's, so she's good. But now what if she wasn't good though? You know what I'm saying? She's like, baby, you ain't spending, no time with me.
You spend no time with me. Yeah, and that's the course of success. We can go for another 10 minutes because you started late, so we can go for another 10 minutes. My thing don't cut off. I cut it off anyway. Okay. But that's the thing, is like when you're trying to be, we can go on a little longer. Mm-hmm. When you're striving and you'll come home, you want to be successful. Mm-hmm. You got to put in these long hours, right? You got to study. You got to retrain your mind. Mm-hmm. What I mean? You got to change your inner circle, right? You got to be, you got to be with people that support you regardless if you fall or not, right? And we got to be able to pull ourselves up, to increase ourselves. And mm-hmm. that inner circle that we have, you know, for our family and friends, mm-hmm. you know, they don't understand that hustle. Like, because it's like, it's like, and I look at it, it's kind of like, it's kind of like fear. It's like mm-hmm. fear is a motivator. Mm-hmm. For a lot yes. of people that come out of prison, fear mm-hmm. is that motivator that mm-hmm. that keeps them abreast, because they're like, I don't want to go back to prison.
Right.
You know, I don't want to make another mistake. And then if I get into any type of financial strongholds, like mm-hmm. if I lose my job, you know what I mean? And I'm hearing about cuts all over the city. I've been to rallies and talk about cuts. Mm-hmm. But they're not saying, they say cuts, but they're not saying, well, we lost 50 employees because of these mm-hmm. cuts. We lost 120 employees because this is the solidarity that has to come together when we're looking at these different organizations. Mm-hmm. The solidarity has to come together where they actually start mapping out statistically what these cuts look like in real time.
Exactly.
And showing that how these cuts are actually destroying lives, you know, because yeah, you might have been working for 5 years, but you know, a lot of time we're working, like just most of us, 90% of us actually come out of prison. We're working paycheck to paycheck.
Exactly.
We don't have a nest egg that you was talking about. We don't have a $20,000 nest egg in case things go wrong. No, we're working from paycheck to paycheck because now we're paying for our own health insurance. You know, we're paying for life insurance. You know, if you're investing in stocks, bonds, mutual right. funds, that's dedication.
That's dedication. Right. And you know sacrifice. I mean? Sacrifice
out.
Too.
Sacrifice. Yeah, you got money coming out of your account. If you're doing auto, that money come out
exactly,
of your account.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. You don't even see that. You're like that.
You don't see that. You can't afford it. You can't afford to lose your job. You can't afford right. to have no major hiccup because you're trying to create financial freedom.
Exactly.
So if you was to get caught up in some type of net, you know what I'm saying, where you like, oh, wow, I'm gonna have to stop my auto. I'm gonna have to stop doing this. I'm gonna have to. Mm-hmm. I can't drink Starbucks no more. I'm gonna have to go and get Dunkin' Donuts. Right? You know, these are life changing things. A lot of times it messes with our psyche because we associate ourselves to these different things, and these different things are actually create our lives for us.
Exactly.
Like the more things we accumulate, the more we identify with those things that we accumulate.
That's a fact.
Take precedence over our own lives. Like we're having a messed up day if I can't get my Starbucks. I'll probably have a real, really messed up day.
Exactly. Right. No, that's true.
Yeah.
No, I was just gonna say.
No, jump in.
You're absolutely right, because you know, going back to, like I said, from the 80s, not realizing how marketing, right, how prevalent it is. Right. And how it really affects our psyche. And we begin to identify with brands. Right. That's the American way, whether it's Starbucks or whether it's Gucci or whatever. It's like, that's my thing. Right.
That's my thing. And imagine you can't buy it.
Especially if you can't buy it. Right. Because
imagine you can't buy this book for $16.99. That's the price I see now. They took down to $9.99.
That's excellent.
$99, but right now it's $16.99. But imagine you can't get this book to actually learn. I'm gonna actually get this book, you know what I mean, to learn what it is you're talking about.
Exactly.
And we can actually share about it again. You might even put a chart out the next time we have our show.
Okay.
And you can actually show the different dynamics of what this is, because mm-hmm. we're in the space of moving in real time. No, right?
Exactly.
People come out of prison are faced with housing. Finances, mm-hmm. going back into that space of social responsibility. What is social responsibility? Because mm-hmm. many of us don't know what social responsibility is, because this is why we wound up in prison. We wasn't socially responsible to our communities. Mm-hmm. We wasn't a part of advocacy movements, and we wasn't creating nonprofits. We wasn't thinking about a nonprofit until we got incarcerated. The concept of nonprofit never came across. We didn't see nonprofit representatives walking down Best Side. You know what I'm saying? Right. With tags on and shirts on, talking about we can help you change your life. I've never seen any of those things.
It wasn't
until I was incarcerated that I heard about this organization or that mm-hmm. organization or this mm-hmm. organization. But mm-hmm. these organizations out here, when I was running the streets of Brooklyn, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, that could actually try to help me save my life by giving me a new concept on life. Exactly. But I never heard about them. So it's like a lot of these places are set up for when you get incarcerated. They're not They're not preventative organizations.
Right. That's why, to your point earlier, the thing, I'm on a mission, among other things, to break that mold, to break that paradigm, right? We have to break that paradigm. So one of the things, and this may sound self-serving, but it is the truth. Books have changed my life. I'm serious. Books I've read, I must have read about 1,000 books while I was inside. I'm not exaggerating. I always been an avid reader, and I had all this time on my hands, and mm-hmm. I was very clear from the beginning. I'm not getting caught up with this mess, man. All this other stuff that's going on, the violence and all that. Everybody trying to be tough. I want to be mentally tough. I want to go home and stay home. Yeah, right? I want to be on that side. You know what I'm saying? So that's the way I did it. And so I, you know, like you said. Buy my book, Think Outside the Cell, an entrepreneur's guide for the incarcerated folks. And I can almost guarantee that even if you don't start your own business, that you will be able to pay it forward to someone else or some, and you don't have to be formally incarcerated, to be honest, right? Or incarcerated.
That's right.
I've had other people read the book and talk about how enlightening it was. And I put a lot into it, so you're not going to walk away, you know, not knowing something that, you know, that you didn't know before. You're going to learn something new. But another point that I want to raise is this. Even all of us, are, you know, we all on this journey. The paths is different. It may look a little different, stuff like that. Even I had recently a couple of aha moments, right? But, and I'm going back to the Millionaire Fast Lane just to make the point in terms of entrepreneurship. Now, this past year, I'm not going to get into the figures per se, but this year, 2023, because we get funding from my organization that I work for, we get funding from the city, right? So now I don't know. I mean, there's going to be some cuts all over the place because Adam talked about that, right? We got a lot of stuff going on, the migrant situation, and you know. So my point though is that several times this year, about 2 or 3 times this year, we got bonuses. Everybody bonuses. I'm talking about several $1,000, $3,000 here, $5,000 here, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know where, on top of my paycheck. Now, we had the choice. We were given the choice, the option to have it go to our paycheck, right? And be taxed. Everything going to be taxed, right? Or to have it go into our 401k. So now I don't regret it, but I had the money go to my 401k because I'm thinking, okay, I want to make sure I got that nice nest egg. I'm not in my 30s. I'm not in my 40s. Like I said, I'm 53. Right? I'd be 54. Mm-hmm. Eight. So I'm thinking long term, right? Now, like I said, it's nothing bad with that per se, because I could have just, if I was the type like how I was 30 years ago, I would have took the money, went shopping, took a trip, you know, all this other stuff, right? And I'm sure a lot of my colleagues did do that, right? My point is this. I had an aha moment a couple of weeks ago, I would say maybe 2 months ago, where I'm like, okay, I should have took the money, right? Instead of having it go into the 401k, right? Which is going into investments and all this mm-hmm. other stuff, which is cool. I should have invested it in my own business. A light bulb went off and I'm like, okay, it's not like I did a bad thing, but it wasn't the smartest thing, because one of the things he talks about the millionaire fast lane is basically the slow lane is to invest in the stock market, which, you know, I do believe in investing in the stock market. Don't get me wrong. I teach that, I coach and all that stuff, but it is the slow lane. It is the slow lane. If I take, I'll say this last thing. If I take $5,000, for example, that
you can still go, you can still talk. Bonus, you got a little time.
Right? Great. So if I that $5,000 that I had go into the stock market through mutual funds, through my 401k at work, it might take, for example, they have a concept called the rule of 72. And basically it's a formula that works. It's a rule that works in a way that says, if you know, for example, that you can make 10% a year, you divide 72 by 10, and your money can double in 7 years, right? So he's like, okay, that's not too bad. If you make more, if you make 24%, I'm just using that number, right? Then every 3 years, your money would double. And when I say double, that's the whole. It's the whole concept of compound interest is based on the rule of 72, right? So it's your money doubling, I mean, doubling quickly after some time, right? Now, that's all well and good. That is really good, right? But if I had taken that $5,000 or if I have taken $5,000 and instead invested it in my business, right, very strategically, then I could double in a year or less instead of 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. You see what I'm saying? And sure. I have like how the author Millionaire Messenger, that's another book I read, but the Millionaire Fastlane, if I had taken it and invested myself, I have more control. The stock market, you don't have any control. You put the money in and hope that it does well. You do your research. You should do your research, right? And then you hope that it does well, right? Exactly, right? So the main point is that for this year, 2024, I'm invested in me and my business. Same thing with my book. That is an investment. It's not just reading a book. I've read books. Yeah. I'm sure you have too. That
definitely.
Whether I read them, whether I got them free, somebody bought it for me, or I bought it, that have literally changed my whole mindset, shifted. Once your mindset shifts, then your behavior follows, right? If you want different outcomes, you know, they have the same, it's similar to like computers. What goes in is what goes out. So if garbage comes in, garbage goes out. Good stuff comes out.
That's right. Those are great models, you know, because when you're looking at the 401k, and I'm pretty sure you got that in your readings, that the 401k is associated to the market, you know what I'm saying, to the mm-hmm. stock market. So mm-hmm. it depends on how good the stock market is, because behind that 401k is an investment company, mm-hmm. right? It's in a financial investment company that's actually, mm-hmm. you got to depend on some unknown mm-hmm. man or woman that you don't know, because a lot mm-hmm. of times we don't even go see our financial advisors. Mm-hmm. That's associated to the 401k to understand mm-hmm. what type of investment that they're doing mm-hmm. and how would those investments benefit 10, 15, maybe even 20 years down the line.
Exactly.
And because we don't know the relationship, we just take it by value that right. we're in good hands, like we're in a good state, but we don't know what they'll invest. They might invest in apples and then they might have an apple drought, and the next thing you know, you lost all your money.
Exactly.
Because you can lose your money in the 401k as well.
Yep.
So it's basically like, if you don't understand the market, mm-hmm. how did you invest in something that you don't understand? Because, you know, we take it as a principle thought that these organizations have our best interest at heart. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, whether it may be for profit or nonprofit, these are businesses that's in the business of making money.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right?
Yes.
They're in business of making money. And how do they continue to make money? Mm-hmm. Right, I've been in nonprofits where they started losing money and they started cutting off the top heads of the mm-hmm. organization to mm-hmm. keep the money flowing inside mm-hmm. the organization. They started demoting people from being directors to supervisors, mm-hmm. from supervisors to case managers, you know what I'm saying, from case managers to walk out the door. They have actually seen this process in real time. Mm-hmm. So you'll see that organization at the end of the day, you may deem it that they're your friend. Well, you might say, this is my friends in here. I work with my mm-hmm. friends, right? But at the end of the day, this is a business model.
I'll be right there. And,
yeah, yes, and this business model. This business model changes over time. The face of Fortune Society has changed.
Yeah.
You know, they got it.
Exodus, for sure.
Exodus. You know, they got a new CEOs and Exodus. Mm-hmm. You know, Julio Medina left. You know, you have another guy that's actually taken over. Mm-hmm. But what is his name that took over Fortune Society as a CEO?
Oh, Stanley Richards, yeah.
Stanley Richards, he's the yep. first black person to actually been a CEO mm-hmm. of a nonprofit organization.
Of that size.
So the faces of these organizations are changing, mm-hmm. right? And because they're changing, the economical principles of these systems are also going to change. And there's really nothing nobody can do about it, because the organizations have to be able to survive the political storm mm-hmm. that's taking place. There's a political storm, like a wildfire, mm-hmm. that's running through the land right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And because it's running and it's like unabated, right?
Many
organizations are getting caught up in that trap, because mm-hmm. the concept of what you're talking about, financial freedom, mm-hmm. doesn't really exist within the core of these organizations.
Exactly.
These organizations depend on government funded, they depend on philanthropists, they depend on donators and stuff like that. They're mm-hmm. not a well-oiled machine where they can operate that we need all these to pour in, you know what I'm saying, to the structure in order for them to have the principle of actually being financially free. And this is something that, as far as individuals, that we have to start taking into accountability that, yeah, we go into these spaces, we go work, you know, we try to structure ourselves, but at the end of the day, these are businesses, and these businesses are not teaching financial freedom. They're teaching you about the caseloads, how to do billing, but they're not teaching you per se as an individual
how to be independent.
Yeah. They're not using the rule of 72. Is the rule of 72? Because I was seeing a graph when I looked at this up. I don't see the rule of 72 on no wall when I went to a nonprofit organization.
Right. They're not because you hit on something. Money has a psychology and a language. We got to get both. Especially people of color. I'm not excluding anyone, but I'm saying.
Yeah, but especially us that's in that space.
We got to get it. That's what I've been on a mission. That's what I'm about, right? And normalizing conversations about this. See how, like, we're talking about it? We need to talk about it like we talk about everything else. We talk about sports. Yeah, and, you know, why we ain't talking about, you know what I'm saying, the next generation, what we got set aside, or how we going to bring them in the fold. And when it comes to money, we going from intergenerational poverty, we need to change that up. So it has to start from somewhere, right? It doesn't have to be a huge undertaking from the outset, but it has to start somewhere, and it starts with our psychology. I'll say this thing, and I know we got a few minutes, and then I know you got some things going on. But the foundation of mindful money is based on a three-part framework. Think of it as a pyramid. The base of the pyramid is mindfulness, right? So before we get into all this, the money stuff, as far as us as a people, it's about being aware of your emotions when it comes to money, your thoughts when it comes to money, and your behavior when it comes to money. It's real simple. So it's about mindfulness. We know when, you know, a lot of times we know when we can't afford something, when we just, you know, we, whatever we want to call it, we want to floss and we want to get all this extra. I'm not saying we not to have a nice life. Or what we consider a nice life. But what I'm saying is our behavior, our thinking and all that, when it comes to money, need to be in accordance with our values, our core values, not somebody else's values, not what other people say we should have, family members, friends, your colleagues, whatever. What is important to you? What do you want out of life and why, right? It's about unpacking all that stuff. So at the root of it is mindfulness, right? I'll just say that, whether it's, you know, being very aware. And a good example of that is like when a lot of us go shopping, right? The term they call it is retail therapy. So a lot of times, instead of seeing a therapist or talking through our anxieties and fears when it comes to money, we go shopping instead, right? Mm-hmm. We feel good for a minute until that credit card bill come in. Then we don't feel good anymore, right? So we need to work through that stuff. So it's the mindfulness is the first part. The second rung or second tier is mindset, but not just any mindset. It's an ownership mindset. Other people understand that. Not everybody, but you know what I'm saying. Other people understand an ownership mindset. They own the company, like I said. Even the CEO of a company doesn't own the company unless they do own it, right? But usually they don't. They don't, right? So it's the person who owns the company who's getting the real money, right? Whether it's for-profit or non-profit, right? Now, non-profit, obviously, you know, you can't own it in the sense that like a for-profit. But my point is that we need to have an ownership mindset instead of a consumer mindset. Many of us have a consumer mindset because that's the way, that's the American way. That's what they teach, right? So we're not to be honest, we're not to be faulted for some of this stuff because this is the American way. This is what they've been teaching from the foundation of the country, right? Yeah. Now, and think of it like a balance sheet, right? When I think of an ownership mindset versus a consumer mindset, think of it as a balance sheet. You got assets, you got liabilities. An ownership mindset focuses on assets, owning stuff, things that increase in value. Consumer mindset focuses on liabilities, things that they got to charge on their card or they get a loan and all this other stuff like that. And they more and more in debt. And guess who they in debt to? guess who they in debt to? They in debt to the people who have the ownership mindset.
That's right. Really, yeah, depreciation. Really we depreciate our own lives to basically increase the lives of others.
Exactly. And this is what I teach my grandson. Yeah. I teach the people in my life. Yeah. The last part of the pyramid at the top, the pinnacle, is money management, smart money management. So most of us, I got family members, yeah, I got $500, I got $1,000. Show me how to invest. That's good. That's a good start. But mm-hmm. what I also always say, okay, we're going to talk about that, but let's talk about mindfulness. Let's talk about ownership mindset. Let's talk about those foundational things. Because if we don't, if we think it's just about the money, right, we're going to lose sight and we're going to probably make some bad choices, right? Because that like a lot of us. So I just wanted to make sure I get that in and say it to your listeners that we need to be mindful. We need to have an ownership mindset. And then we can focus on the money management part. Once you ground it, you got that foundation like a house, right? Then you can build up.
So we wanted down. We're gonna close at 1:30. But I wanted to know, tell people where they could reach you at. You know, let them know how they can reach out to you. Mm-hmm. What platforms you on? Do you have any of these? Do you have any course studies that people can reach out to? You have a page that people can study. Yeah. Some of the terminology and stuff like that you've been using and stuff like that. So,
I appreciate it. Yeah. So one, if you have any questions, you can reach me at mindfulmoneyllc.com. So that's mindful money, one word, mindfulmoneyllc.com. Let me take that back. That's email at mindfulmoney@gmail.com. Right? mindfulmoneyllc@gmail.com. This email. My website is mindfulmoneyllc.com. That's what I meant to say. And I'm on most of the social media platforms, mostly though Facebook and Instagram, right? So I can be Instagram. My handle is mindfulmoneyllc. And you can also reach me the same way on Facebook. I'm on TikTok, not as often. I intend to do more YouTube videos. Like I said, got to get out there with that. I do have a YouTube platform. I'm also on LinkedIn. That's how we got connected.
We got connected through LinkedIn.
I meet a lot of people. I'm easy to find. And again, like I said, any of those platforms, you can get in touch. And the thing is, we really need to, as a people, we really need to, begin to shift our mindset when it comes to money and get out of this rat race, as they call it, this 9-to-5 rat race. I appreciate my job, right? I do mean that, but it's a stepping stone, right? It's a stepping stone. Yeah. It's not the end all be all.
It should be a stepping stone, but what I've been seeing, because I've been in the nonprofit sector and an advocacy sector since like 2007, since my release. Mm-hmm. And what I've been seeing is like it's like a slow turning wheel, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And you don't see that type of increase. I had a guy reach out to me a couple months ago and was like, they have a community organizer position, and I was like, what's the salary? He said $27,000 a year, and I was like, $27,000 a year? Can't do nothing with that.
No grown person is going to do that.
Yeah, you can't do nothing with that. You know what I mean? So it's like, even though you're going to an organization and they're making millions of dollars and they own properties and they own different things like that, they're not making an assessment that the individuals come out of prison need financial strongholds to break out of these systematic homes so they can actually save their sons and daughters on a legacy standpoint.
Right.
Because one of the things that I've learned from incarceration is that the police officer, the Department of Correction within itself, depends on the livestock of people mm-hmm. in order for it to exist, because at the mm-hmm. end of the day, it is a business. They may talk about it as far as incarceration or people committing crimes and the space of criminology, but at the end of the day, it is a business within itself. It's just like a nonprofit, it's like a corporation. They're all one and the same.
It's a business.
A business keep flowing? And need product and services. And unfortunately, because of the prison system within itself, people are the product and services of the prison system.
Exactly.
So if people stop doing crime, then what happens to the prison system?
Exactly. And you're absolutely right. When I was inside, I was really, and it, in addition to like, you know, teaching classes and stuff like that and giving presentations, running organizations, stuff like that, is we wrote white papers. We sent, you know, pieces to Albany, to Parole, to Docs, and in terms of like changing, making systemic changes, you know. And one of the things that I found out in my research, going to your point about it being a business, is that I know this was some years ago, I haven't checked out in a while. Docs's budget, the Department of Corrections and Community Supervisions in New York State, the budget was $3 billion, billion with a B. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money, right?
A lot of money.
And yet, and I gave this presentation, I said this recently at my job, I had to speak to some law students. I work at, like I said, a nonprofit law firm. And I doubt very much that they have decreased that budget, right?
I'm pretty sure it's higher now.
It's higher now. That's what I'm saying. And I say that because back then when I was inside, they were saying, all right, $3 billion budget, 60,000, you know, incarcerated men and women in New York State. You do the math, you know, it's 50,000 ahead, right? Because you're talking about property, right?
That's right.
Now we're talking 35,000 or 33,000, right? But the budget is now probably 3.5 or 3.2 or whatever it is. So that means each person is quote unquote worth about 70,000, right? So you got fewer incarcerated people, in some instances, fewer staff, but the budget remains the same or larger.
Still growing.
It's still growing.
We are the property. We are the property of the Department of Corrections once we become incarcerated. Exactly. And Department of Corrections, basically property is also on a New York City Stock Exchange, right? Mm-hmm. So we need to understand that we are associated to the stock market anytime that we get incarcerated. It's not a free incarceration. Not incarceration. Mm-hmm. Turns into industrial complexes.
Exactly.
To the point we're making mattresses, license plates, clothing, glasses, and we're also on the New York City Stock Exchange. Exactly. Your name might not be there, but that number that you was associated to when you was incarcerated, that number is associated to the New York Stock Exchange.
Exactly.
So like in the end of the day, it's understanding that this is a business.
That people know, you raise a good point, because people have some people have a vested interest in our incarceration, right?
Yeah,
so
because
now
we
got to take it back. Exactly.
We got to take it back. And I definitely commend you, Joseph, you know, actually creating this book, actually creating this LLC, shows that we have the propensity, we have the ability to bring forth change. Mm-hmm. We have the ability to basically start anew and actually create new markets for our lives in the world. These markets, these economical markets have actually used us to increase other markets. Exactly. Now it's up to us as individuals that have actually been forming incarcerated and things of that nature to bring new awareness to new markets that actually exist within ourselves, the things that we have learned, what we have developed in prison, and actually how we bring it out in real time and increase each other. So I did send you my number in a private chat.
Okay, great.
Please reach out to me. Let's talk. Yep, I said you said you're going to be in Brooklyn tomorrow. We can meet tomorrow if you got time after your presentation, whatever. I definitely love to talk to you. I get people reach out to me all the time, you know, just coming home. They need structure, they need insight. This will be a great gift for me to actually give to other individuals as well. And you know, just keep doing what you're doing.
I appreciate that. Get into these
other places, get into these colleges, these universities, become a keynote speaker with the Department of Corrections.
Right.
This is what's really important, and make sure that they pay you when you go into these different spaces.
No, that's right. That's right. Because I know.
Yeah.
Some of them are my friends. They VPs at certain orgs, and they like, oh, I don't know if we got in the budget. I'm like, all right. You got to pay me. You got to value my time, my expertise, my energy.
Yeah, I didn't get into this room by mishap. I brought myself into this room. You have to solidify my stance so I can continue to not only just come into this room, but also venture to other rooms, because profit entity is a space that has to be dismantled from the inside out and not from the outside in. It has to come. We have to get into these spaces, into these rooms to dismantle their systems, or they will continue to dismantle us according to communities. They basically have connections to certain communities. mm-hmm. and they use these communities to actually get their livestock to be inside their system. They may call it criminality, but right. at the end of the day, we know what criminality looks like, and we also know what reform looks like because we've been on both sides of the spectrum.
Yeah. Thanks again, though, man. Thanks again. And we'll do it again. You just let me know, and we won't have the glitches next time. I got it.
No problem. We actually did the whole hour, so don't even worry about it.
So we got it. You know, all right?
Text me. Hit me up, man. Let's connect.
Let's
do it. Everybody, peace. Welcome to IAMTHEDATA. Thanks for stopping in.
Peace. All right, peace.
Good day, brother. Peace.
Peace.
It's probably like.